Hi, I'm William Claflin. I am looking for a teaching job in the humanities.
It was a small enough school, though. It was the only social studies for the teacher for the entire upper school. So I got to teach geography, world history, U.S. history, government. I also taught an elective journalism class, and I did SAT prep. I was also did the after-school homework program for the school as well.
So what was your favorite thing to teach there?
I would say U.S. history. I was able to develop my own, the U.S. history course. The students at the time were kind of above the other students. I mean, they were pretty sophisticated, just happened the luck of that class. And I developed a U.S. history course for them using two books, Paul Johnson's History of the United States, which is kind of a conservative outlook of U.S. history, and then Howard Zinn's People's History, which is more liberal. So I kind of used the two books in concert, and we read different articles and saw movies also to leaven that content. So it gave the students they were able to attack two real history books. I did use textbooks. I was able, because of the quality of the students, I asked the principal if I could have permission to go off of the textbooks and create my own course. I did, showed him my plans, and he said run with it. Otherwise, I used the textbook that the school provided, but I use them more as a guide just for the content of the class. And I always bring in the extra materials, whether it's, for one thing I do, it's I take a piece of writing using the op-ed piece from the New York Times every single class to begin the class, and we deconstruct the piece. We find the thesis in it. We circle all the words that we're not sure the definition. We break down the piece. We discuss it, and then try to link it to the overall content of the class. I guess what made me the proudest probably is the context I had for my students when they were in college, and they would call me up and say, Mr. Claflin, now I know why you assigned that piece. We had read Flannery O'Connor, and the student was very excited, called me and said, oh my gosh, we read those same short stories in college English. So midway through the second year I was teaching there, Mr. Boyd took me out of the classroom. That's always a little, and the principal wants to, you're actually teaching and he wants to speak to you in the hall. And I go out there and he's really, really excited. He's got these papers in front of him. And he says, look at these scores. And I said, okay. And he said, these are the verbal scores. These have gone up dramatically. And I said, okay. He goes, no, you don't understand. You're not even the English teacher. These are the English scores. I really do believe you brought up the verbal scores of the entire school. And so he was, quite excited about that. I believe you have to teach kids, you have to recognize their abilities. So often got different work than some of the other students. She was very bright, very ambitious. So, her work was often harder and needed work on very basic skills so he could thrive in whatever college he was going to. I think he was actually bound for a community college, and he has thrived. But I think it's important for a teacher to recognize this, because you've got to realize that they're all your students. You're trying to get them all to their goals. Yes, they always have a writing assignment that they're working on, but we also always have a project. Now, a lot of these projects, sometimes they'll be assigned to three or four students. Sometimes it'll actually be a class-wide project. One of them that I was really proud of is each student had to go out and they had to do some form of public activism. Whether it was, finding, they could choose for themselves what that was. But they had to go out and participate in the political process, however they wanted to do it. And they had to build the plan. They had to write me a memo of describing what it is so I could okay it to make sure that they're not doing anything too radical. And then they would kind of, in this particular project, they would, all along the way, they would be telling me what they're up to. And then they would have an in presentation to the entire class, and they would have to use, it would have to be a multimedia presentation. What she did was, or one of the students, wrote all the members of the House of Representatives in North Carolina for an issue. And, she wrote them and asked a question. And then the project kind of evolved, And I said, well, you're not going to move them that way, but this is really interesting. So what we did was she sent all the letters, and then we kind of analyzed the lawmakers' responses, whether they wrote back at all, whether they got some canned response, whether they disagreed with it, and then we kind of wrote an overall paper on that. And that was really interesting.
So you've talked a lot about reading, and it seems like you have a real passion for reading and maybe reading things outside of school that you then brought into the classroom. Can you tell me a little bit about what you've read recently and maybe how you're bringing that into the classroom?
Sure. I think my wife would say that's one of the only things I do at home is read, and that's not true. I keep up with the yard work. But my passion is reading and keeping up with cultural events, or I guess, in lack of a better way to put it, keeping up with my subject that I teach. It's what I do anyway. Right now I'm reading Evan Thomas's great biography of Eisenhower during the presidential years. On any given day, I read two national newspapers a day, the New York Times and Wall Street Journal, the Washington Post. I also keep up with the leading magazines that are having have these big think pieces, the New Yorker, the Atlantic. This works really well because I would be doing it anyway, but this is also what I bring into the classroom. I just love to go in with the latest current events controversy and go over it with my students, and we do this every day. My classes are structured that way. The body of the class is on the curriculum, what we're trying to do. The end of the class is normally the projects that we're working on, but the beginning of the class is for current events, what's going on, and I try to tie it into the subject matter. If you don't know your content, the kids know right away. First week they get it. I mean, they really do. If you have to go, if they ask you a question, you go and you pick up the textbook, well, let's see here, they're going to find out right away. So you have to know your content inside and out.
So tell me more about what you've done professionally outside of teaching that's sort of given you background in teaching government.
Sure. When I was in graduate school at University of Richmond for political science, I got the chance to intern at the General Assembly for one of the delegates. Delegates Pandy Rhodes, and I was basically her legislative assistant. From then, the next year, I decided to apply to be a legislative assistant for another delegate as a job, and I was hired by Delegate Bill Mims, and I was his legislative assistant for 2 years. And, you know, it was great. I mean, you watch laws being made, you watch government right there. You know, you're right there where the governor is. I think it's great experience. After that, I was quite young, still in graduate school, 26 years old. I got the idea that I was going to run for school board. Richmond City had its first ever elected school board election, and I decided that I was going to run. Well, I looked about 12, but I did it anyway. I will say that I came in 3 out of 4 candidates. I came in third, but the experience of actually running for office, doing everything, has just been great in the classroom because I think I'm able to bring government to life to my students.
As a teacher, I'm sure you've had a lot of communication with parents, whether it's about grades or a situation that's happening in the classroom. Can you tell me a little bit about how you handle those kinds of emails and those questions?
Sure. I mean, I guess the short answer is I like to head them off before they happen. I'm very proactive with my communication with the parents. Typically, I give the kids benefit of the doubt for the first couple of weeks. If I see a problem in the grades in their work, I call a parent-teacher conference and sit down with both the parent and the child, and we figure out what's going on. We get some sort of action step, some sort of follow-up date, and kind of go that way. At the last school I worked in, I had a policy where I'm an early riser. I get to school early, and I had the first hour before school started where both parents and students could drop by with their concerns. I typically had 2 or 3 kids doing their homework at the, you know, in my class before school started. You know, I just think this is very, very important.
You're obviously really passionate about what you do. Can you tell me why you got into teaching?
I got into teaching because I was called to teach several years ago. I just had an overwhelming feeling that this is something I could really do. Lifelong, I've been reading and passionate about my subject, which is broadly, I would say, American studies, anything from American literature to government to art history. I just love it. And it just occurred to me that I can share this with students. There's nothing I would rather be doing than reading books, reading magazine articles, discussing them with kids, teaching them critical thinking, teaching them about current events, teaching them to get ready for the college classroom. I just love everything about it.